In 1931, Japanese troops invaded Manchuria, causing turmoil in northern China. With Beijing under threat, the imperial collection was moved south to Shanghai for safekeeping. 5 years later, the treasure moved again, this time to specially built storage facilities in Nanjing. And then in 1937, Japan invaded China en masse. To protect the collection, it was split up and sent westward, the largest movement of cultural relics in history. 16,000 crates were on the move, in trucks and on trains. They were hauled along on horse carts. They floated along rivers in boats. This was an unprecedented mission to preserve Chinese culture under the constant threat of aerial bombardment. A dedicated group of treasure escorts risked their lives to protect these precious relics on an arduous 10,000-kilometer journey. 83-year-old Gao Renjun is one of the few surviving escorts from that turbulent time.
We knew this treasure was very important and very valuable. That's why we were moving it from Beijing. We knew these were treasures from thousands of years of Chinese culture.
The crates under Mr. Gao's care were never unpacked. They were ready to be moved whenever the threat of war got too close.
We could see the planes flying back and forth, back and forth. So we were nervous. When we got on the Yangtze River, we saw a huge explosion. We were very nervous.
When Japan was defeated in 1945, palace museum officials started reassembling the collection, bringing it back to Nanjing from the many storage sites around China, all intact, all artifacts accounted for. And they were still in danger, because with one war ending, another was flaring. The communists under Mao Zedong and the nationalists under Chiang Kai-shek battled for control of China. By 1948, the nationalists were a beaten force. Their only way out was to retreat to the island of Taiwan, 160 kilometers off the coast of the mainland. The nationalists took the best of the imperial treasure collection to Taiwan with them from Nanjing. Such was the power of the treasure that the regime believed possessing it gave them legitimacy over the communists for control of China.
It felt great. Our job was complete. Mission accomplished. Moving it all here, these antiquities, thousands of years worth of culture, moving it to Taiwan. Everyone was very happy.
A total of 3,824 crates were shipped to Taiwan in 1948 and 1949, the cream of the imperial collection. It was initially stored in sugar factories, but fear of aerial bombardment meant a safer refuge had to be found. A cave vault dug into a hill in the suburbs of Taipei, Taiwan's capital, became the final, rather unusual resting place for a treasure that had adorned emperors' palaces for centuries. Having the treasure was one thing, but keeping it in a cave was not an option. As experts went through the collection, taking a full inventory and cataloging artifacts, work began on a museum to be built at the head of the tunnel on the Taipei hillside. 15 years after the cream of the imperial treasure arrived in Taiwan, it was put on public display in 1965. Its new home, the National Palace Museum. The museum resides in Taipei, capital of Taiwan, a regional economic powerhouse and a full democracy. In many ways, Taiwan regards itself as the keeper of Chinese culture. And at the heart of this lies the National Palace Museum.
It's almost like a really big legend, the way these artifacts went wandering from place to place. However, even while this was happening, it's really extremely fortunate that these artifacts were preserved. I believe that this process is a result of a lot of people's hard work. And as far as the artifacts and world heritage are concerned, you could even call it a sort of love.
And now, after the most recent renovation, which cost $21 million and was completed in 2007, the treasure has a fitting home, and the museum is ranked among the best in the world. Floors, 29 galleries, and hundreds of cases. This is the National Palace Museum in Taiwan. Have been handled by only a select few outside the imperial court since the Emperor Qianlong himself set them down. Precision and care are paramount. Time with these objects is itself priceless and rare, so no slips can be made. There is no room for error. Once all preparations have been made, the system begins to run. The camera is a special design. It takes a single vertical picture over and over again. As the vase rotates, slowly a picture is built up. It's as if the vase is being unrolled, flattened, so we can fully appreciate the artistry that went into its creation. Once the picture has been created, the work isn't over. It's checked in detail by the technicians. Any flaws, and the process will have to begin again. Who knows when the vase will next be made available? Once they're satisfied, the picture will be stored, the 21st century way of backing up historic art. Just as Qianlong did over 200 years ago, the museum continues to catalog the collection. Images like this will also ultimately be available to the public, no longer just kept for the eyes of the emperor and his family. These treasures are being given to the world.